Act 3, Scene 2, The Forum. Brutus and Cassius are a little apart from the mob, talking together.
Cassius, go you into the other street and part the numbers. Those that will hear me speak, let them stay here. Those that will follow Cassius, go with him. And public reason shall be rendered of Caesar's death.
I will hear Brutus speak. I will hear Cassius and compare their reasons when suddenly we hear them rendered.
Cassius goes off, followed by a part of the throng. Brutus mounts to the pulpit.
Be patient till the last. Romans, countrymen, and lovers, hear me for my cause, and be silent that you may hear. Believe me for mine honor, and have respect to mine honor that you may believe. Censure me in your wisdom, and awake your senses that you may the better judge. If there be any in this assembly, any dear friend of Caesar's, to him I say that Brutus's love to Caesar was no less than his. If then that friend demand why Brutus rose against Caesar, this is my answer. Not that I loved Caesar less, but that I loved Rome more. Had you rather Caesar were living and die all slaves than that Caesar were dead? To live all free men. As Caesar loved me, I weep for him. As he was fortunate, I rejoice at it. As he was valiant, I honor him. But as he was ambitious, I slew him. There is tears for his love, joy for his fortune, honor for his valor, and death for his ambition. Who is here so base? That would be a bondman. If any, speak, for him have I offended. Who is here so rude that would not be a Roman? If any, speak, for him have I offended. Who is here so vile that will not love his country? If any, speak, for him have I offended. I pause for a reply.
None, Brutus, none.
Then none have I offended. I have done no more to Caesar than you shall do to Brutus. The question of his death is enrolled in the Capitol.
Enter Mark Antony. After him come attendants bearing Caesar's body covered over with a cloak.
Here comes his body, mourned by Mark Antony, who, though he had no hand in his death, shall receive the benefit of his dying, a place in the Commonwealth. As which of you shall not? With this I depart, that as I slew my best lover for the good of Rome, I have the same dagger for myself, when it shall please my country to need my death.
Live, Brutus!
Live! Live. Live.
Bring him with triumph home to his home!
Give him a statue with an ancestor!
Let him be Caesar!
Caesar's better part shall be crowned in Brutus.
We'll bring him to his house with shouts and clamor.
My countrymen! Good countrymen, let me depart alone, and for my sake, stay here with Antony. Do grace to Caesar's corpse and grace his speech, tending to Caesar's glories, which Mark Antony, by our permission, is allowed to make. I do entreat you, not a man depart, save I alone, till Antony have spoke.
The crowd parts to give him way. Exit Brutus.
Say, oh, let him go on, Mark Antony!
For Brutus' sake,
I say hold you.
For Brutus' sake, he finds himself beholding to us all.
For best he speaks the harm of Brutus here.
The Caesar was a tyrant.
We are blessed Romans, rid of him.
You gentle Romans, friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him. The evil that men do lives after them. The good is oft interred with their bones. So let it be with Caesar. The noble Brutus hath told you Caesar was ambitious. If it were so, it was a grievous fault, and grievously hath Caesar answered it. Here under leave of Brutus and the rest, for Brutus is an honorable man, so are they all honorable men.
come I to speak in Caesar's funeral. He was my friend, faithful and just to me. But Brutus says he was ambitious, and Brutus is an honorable man. He hath brought many captives home to Rome, whose ransoms did the general coffers fill. Did this in Caesar seem ambitious? When that the poor have cried, Caesar hath wept. Ambition should be made of sterner stuff. Yet Brutus says he was ambitious, and Brutus is an honorable man. You all did Caesar on the Lupercal. I thrice presented him a kingly crown, which he did thrice refuse. Was this ambition? Yet Brutus says he was ambitious, and sure he is an honorable man. I speak not to disprove what Brutus spoke, but here I am to speak what I do know. You all did love him once, not without cause. What cause withholds you then to mourn for him? Oh, judgment! Thou art fled to brutish beasts, and men have lost their reason. Bear with me. My heart is in the coffin there with Caesar, and I must pause till it come back to me.
Antony turns away. There is a silence. Then the first citizen says to his neighbor,
methinks there is much reason in his saying. If thou consider rightly the matter, Caesar has had great wrong.
As he masters, I fear there will a worse come in his place.
But he is worse, he would not take the crown. Therefore, this certainly was not ambitious.
If it be found so, some will dearer by this.
Poor soul, his eyes are red as fire with weeping.
There's not a nobler man in Rome than Antony.
Now march him.
He begins again to speak.
But yesterday, the word of Caesar might have stood against the world. Now lies he there, and none so poor to do him reverence. Oh, masters, if I were disposed to stir your hearts and minds to mutiny and rage, I should do Brutus wrong and Cassius wrong, who you all know are honorable men. I will not do them wrong. I rather choose to wrong the dead, to wrong myself and you, than I will wrong such honorable men. But here's a parchment with the seal of Caesar. I found it in his closet. 'Tis his will. Let but the commons hear this testament, which, pardon me, I do not mean to read, and they would go and kiss dead Caesar's wounds and dip their napkins in his sacred blood, yea, beg a hair of him for memory, and dying, mention it within their wills, bequeathing it as a rich legacy unto their issue.
We'll hear the will. Read it, Mark Antony!
Have patience, gentle friends. I must not read it. It is not meet you know how Caesar loved you. You are not wood, you are not stones, but men. And being men, hearing the will of Caesar, it will inflame you. It will make you mad. 'Tis good you know not you are his heirs.
Read the will. We'll hear it, Antony.
Will you be patient? Will you stay a while? I have o'ershot myself to tell you of it. I fear I wrong the honorable men whose daggers have stabbed Caesar. I do fear it. You will compel me then to read the will? Then make a ring about the corpse of Caesar, and let me show you him that made the will. Shall I descend, and will you give me leave?
Antony comes down the steps.
Nay, press not so upon me. Stand far off.
Antony is standing directly over Caesar's bier.
If you have tears, prepare to shed them now. You all do know this mantle. I remember the first time ever Caesar put it on. 'Twas on a summer's evening in his tent. That day he overcame the Nervii. Look, in this place ran Cassius' dagger through. See what a rent the envious Casca made. Through this, the well-beloved Brutus stabbed. And as he plucked his cursed steel away, mark how the blood of Caesar followed it, as rushing out of doors to be resolved if Brutus so unkindly knocked, or no. For Brutus, as you know, was Caesar's angel. Judge, O you gods, how dearly Caesar loved him.
This was the most unkindest cut of all. For when the noble Caesar saw him stabbed, ingratitude more strong than traitor's arms quite vanquished him, then burst his mighty heart. And in his mantle, muffling up his face even at the base of Pompey's statue, which all the while ran blood, great Caesar fell. What a fall was there, my countrymen. Then I and you and all of us fell down, whilst bloody treason flourished over us. Oh, now you weep. And I perceive you feel a dint of pity. These are gracious drops. Kind souls, what weep you when you but behold our Caesar's vesture wounded? Look you here. Here is himself. Marred, as you see, with traitors. Stay, countrymen! Good friends! Sweet friends! Let me not stir you up to such a sudden flood of mutiny. They that have done this deed are honorable. What private griefs they have, alas, I know not. What made them do it, they are wise and honorable, and will no doubt with reasons answer you. I come not, friends, to steal away your hearts. I am no orator, as Brutus is, but as you know me all, a plain blunt man. I tell you that which you yourselves do know. Show you sweet Caesar's wounds, poor, poor, dumb mouths, and bid them speak for me. But were I Brutus and Brutus Antony, there were an Antony would ruffle up your spirits and put a tongue in every wound of Caesar that should move the stones of Rome to rise and mutiny. Yet hear me, countrymen, yet hear me speak. Why, friends, you go to do you know not what. Wherein hath Caesar thus deserved your loves? Alas, you know not. I must tell you then. You have forgot the will I told you of.
The will? Let's see it! The will!
Here is the will. And under Caesar's seal to every Roman citizen he gives, to every several man, 75 drachmas. Hear me with patience. Moreover, he hath left you all his walks, his private arbors and new planted orchards on this side Tiber. He hath left them you and your heirs forever, common pleasures to walk abroad and recreate yourselves. Here was a Caesar. When comes such another?
Never! Never!
We'll burn his body in the holy place with the brand.
Fire the house of the flame.
Take up the body!
No fetch fire!
Look down, Vengeance!
Look down, Swarm!
Antony is alone. In a while, the sky over the city starts to glow red.
Now let it work. Mischief. Thou art afoot. Take thou what course thou wilt.
A servant comes running in. Antony descends from the pulpit and goes up to him.
How now, fellow?
Sir, Octavius has already come to Rome.
Where is he?
He and Lepidus are at Caesar's house.
And thither will I straight to visit him. He comes upon a wish. Fortune is merry, and in this mood will give us anything.
I heard him say, Brutus and Cassius are rid like madmen through the gates of Rome.
Belike they had some notice of the people, how I had moved them. Bring me to Octavius.